This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Can we give God praise for our organist and our praise ensemble on this evening? If you would take your programs out and join with us in the processional hymn of praise, all are welcome. Let us rejoice in the Lord together. Let the church say amen. Oh, the church ought to say praise the Lord. All are welcome in this place, and all are welcome in that place on Facebook and on YouTube and the church online. Somebody ought to say praise the Lord. This evening, we invite you to share out this worship service on social media so you get to use your phone in church and nobody will be mad at you. Look for Mother Bethel on all streaming platforms, and again, share this out with others. We welcome you to this hallowed place. We're so delighted to have with us the 51st pastor of Mother Bethel, Bishop Jeffrey Nathaniel Leith, and his friends, including Bishop Snorton from the CME Church and all of others that you will hear on this evening. Now, we welcome to the pulpit Mr. Abraham Wright, Churches Uniting in Christ President.
Good evening. You may be seated for about 3 minutes. God has been blessing churches uniting in Christ, but when I got here, I was a complete mess. And so I had to have a little talk with my brother, Richard Allen. You see, I've been here several times as a tourist, but this time we are here as sponsoring a program in somebody else's house, and we are having a good time doing it. That takes boldness to do something like that. So I said, Richard, we're in somebody else's house, your house, this evening, and we're supposed to welcome somebody to your house. And it would have been okay with me, Richard. But it was only 15 minutes ago that I discovered that I did not wash my feet before I left the hotel, and I'm going to be on holy ground. And Richard said, boy, come on in here, all of you. The AME Church, the AME Zion Church, the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, the CME Church, the Episcopal Church, the International Council of Community Churches, the Moravian Church, North Province, the United Church of Christ, and the United Methodist Church. And then Richard said, do you think I did all of that hard work to let the 11th hour in America still be the most segregated hour on earth? No way. Get yourself in there, boy, and do what it is that you're supposed to do. And I am so glad for Richard Allen and all his other workers this evening. I am so glad for this choir with 6 members. If you can do that with 6, God knows you can move hell. You actually can. And you can move it. And I'm absolutely grateful for the welcome and the courtesy that we got from the members of yours. You have taught them well in the Lord. Some preachers teach them well, but they're not in the Lord. They are taught well in the Lord. And we thank you for it. And then I look out in the audience, and I thought CUIC was going to behave itself. And they're just dancing all over the place before the service begins. So what can I say to that except we are gracious to Mother Bethel? We're not extending the welcome. We are welcoming you for welcoming us. And that is what God's children are supposed to do. In one other minute, and then I'm finished, and you can turn to page 2 when you, while I'm trying to find that, page 2 in your booklet. And the point I want to remind you of before I sit down is that as we listen again to the music, and try to behave yourself, please. I'm not saying don't shout, but just try to behave yourself and let them sing, okay? So as you listen to the music, and as you hear the word from the sermon, as we eat the bread and drink the wine, let us remember that we are worshiping under one Lord, one faith, and a one baptism. And that is probably the best honor that we can give Richard Allen and all those others who work for the justice of God before us. So shall we stand? Shall we stand? Yes, you need to stand again. It's page 2, and it's the Declaration of Purpose. We gather to praise God who in Jesus Christ chose us before the world was founded. We gather because God has decided, dedicated us to be without blemish and full of love. Led by the Holy Spirit, we have come, churches united in Christ. In this relationship with one another, we can speak the Christian faith more clearly. With fresh courage, we can oppose the powers that divide our churches and oppress the people of the land. Amen.
Let us confess our sins before God and one another. Holy God, we have promised to love you with heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. We confess to you and to one another that we break the promises and violate this covenant of love. We confess that we are diminished by pride and separation. We acknowledge the sinful divisions of our churches, which keep our ministries unreconciled. We admit our failures in mission of justice and love. We confess that we support systems of racism and other oppression that despoil your incarnate image and violate creation. Merciful God, forgive us. In Jesus Christ, transform our hearts to obey your commandments. Restore our love for one another and proclaim your glory. Ever-living God, our judge and healer, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Everyone who is in Christ has become a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. God, through Christ, has reconciled the world and gives us the ministry of reconciliation. Friends, believe the good news that comes from God. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join me in an attitude of prayer. Eternal One, proclaim your word in the reading of Scripture. Speak to us in the meditations of our hearts. Reveal yourself in the faithfulness of our lives. Through Jesus Christ, we pray.
Love the word of God from the book of Wisdom, chapter 9, verse 1 and 17, and 7 through 18. O God of my ancestors and Lord of mercy, who have made all things by your word, you have chosen me to be king of your people and to be judge over your sons and daughters. You have given command to build a temple on your holy mountain and an altar in the city of your habitation, a copy of the holy tent that you prepared from the beginning. With you is wisdom, she who knows your works and was present when you made the world. She understands what is pleasing in your sight and what is right according to your commandments. Send her forth from the holy heavens, and from the throne of your glory send her, that she may labor at my side, and that I may learn what is pleasing to you. For she knows and understands all things, and she will guide me wisely in my actions and guard me with her glory. Then my works will be acceptable, and I shall judge your people justly, and shall be worthy of the throne of my Father. For who can learn the counsel of God? Or who can discern what the Lord's will? For the reasoning of mortals is worthless, and our designs are likely to fail. For a perishable body weighs down the soul, and this earthly tent burdens the thoughtful mind. We can hardly guess at what is on earth, and what is at hand we find with labor. But who has traced out what is in heaven? Who has learned your counsel? Unless you have given wisdom and sent your body, your Holy Spirit from on high, and thus the paths of those on earth were set right, and people were taught what pleases you and were saved by wisdom. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. The psalm. How good and how pleasant it is. It is like fine oil upon the head flowing down upon the beard. It is like the dew of Hermon flowing down upon the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded his blessings, life forevermore.
The word of God from the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verse 18, through chapter 4, verse 6. Wives, be subject to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this is your acceptable duty in the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, or they may lose heart. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, not only while being watched and in order to please them, but wholeheartedly fearing the Lord. Whatever your task, put yourselves into it as done for the Lord and not for your masters, since you know that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You serve the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for whatever wrong has been done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your slaves justly and fairly, for you know that you also have a master in heaven. Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray for us as well, that God will open to us a door for the word, that we may declare the mystery of Christ, for which I am in prison, so that I may reveal it clearly, as I should. Conduct yourselves wisely toward outsiders, making the most of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer everyone. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
The word of God from the gospel according to Luke, chapter 7, verses 36 through 50. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city, who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind it at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." "A certain creditor had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. Now which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one for whom he canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she had not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven, and she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this man? Who is this who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
President Wright, my colleague Bishop Teresa Jefferson Snorton, the Reverend clergy who are gathered, the officials and members of Churches Uniting in Christ, these members of the AME family who have joined, Bishop Julius McAllister in absentia, who is sending prayers and best wishes, these presiding elders who have come to gather on this day, and beyond the AME family, the Mother Bethel family, for your kindness and support, from the praise ensemble to those who are keeping us safe and transporting us, we greet you with peace and love on this day. I'm grateful to Dr. Tyler, not only for his hospitality, but for him providing this stand for this mic, because he knows I cannot walk and chew gum at the same time. It is also an honor for me to have my wife present this evening, and we appreciate her presence. Before we proceed with the message, we do want to make a note for those who know I'm a lectionary preacher, and when the service planners called and asked me, what are the texts for the service? I said, well, let me go check the schedule for the lectionary, which I did. The only problem is I clicked on May 8th instead of June 8th. And so for those of you who follow the lectionary, these are the readings for May 8th. And I think this was the text the Spirit wanted us to present on this day. Luke, the 7th chapter, the 50th verse, which you've heard. And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." I want to use as a subject this evening, faith-based intimacy. Faith-based intimacy. We gather tonight in Philadelphia, which its name suggests is a city of brotherly love. It has an interesting history, though, when you look at how Philadelphia has dealt with people since its founding. Not only in terms of how property was acquired, but the story gets progressively worse. It is a place where not only does racism play out in terms of in the church and in the community, but it is a place where blacks were not the only ones against whom there was discrimination. Indeed, just down the street, a Roman Catholic church where German immigrants gathered was physically attacked, as was Mother Bethel, by mobs. The French were despised in colonial America, even though a Frenchman, very wealthy, left quite a legacy to the city. In history, Philadelphia, like other places in the United States of America, found opportunities to hate and to discriminate against newcomers in every generation, even up to this day. As egregious as racism is, it is not the only challenge to genuine intimacy which we confront. And while we expect and celebrate our white brothers and sisters to combat racism within their ranks as well as in the general society, black and brown people are not without their own challenges. It's not enough for whites to combat racism, and it's not enough for blacks and others to advocate for justice. No, within my own African-American community, we find ourselves suffering from bias in various sorts. The experts won't call it racism, and that's fine with me, but it's still just wrong. Colorism, classism, xenophobia, challenges where people who are oppressed find themselves in the same sinful condition of denying the image of God in brothers and sisters beyond their fellowship. So we as a people together have a challenge. We as a people together, as God's people, have a calling. And it is a calling to intimacy. An intimacy within our own ranks, because our own fellowships are not without division, not without efforts to separate and misunderstand. And so the intimacy within our denominations is threatened. And the intimacy between our denominations is threatened. Don't be mistaken. Visible unity does not mean you are looking like something that you are not. Visible unity is supposed to mean that you show the world what you really look like, that we are together, we are not apart. And so we find in this text, this interesting encounter there between a man, a woman, Jesus, and other guests at this feast. And in this interaction, what we see is this designation of the sinfulness of the other, a sinfulness that necessitated within the heart and the mind of the self-righteous separation. And, you know, we church folks, we're good at that. We know about that. We want to put the sinful folk out. We want to shut the sinful folk up. We want the sinful folk to be seated in certain places, if at all. We want the sinful folk to clean up before they come in, as though they're coming into a place that is pristine and clean because we are without sin. Jesus goes to the response to the invitation, and the host didn't say it out loud. Notice the text. It says he said to himself. Sometimes we think if we don't speak it out, that we're all right. We can combat and we can eradicate institutional racism, but racism is likely to be around until Jesus comes. Why? Because it is like greed. It is like lust. It is like gluttony. It is a sin of the heart. And you cannot eradicate the sin of another person's heart. All you can do is help them not to pollute the rest of the creation with their sinfulness. And so this man, thinking to himself, he says, I'm not polluting anything. I'm keeping this to myself. If Jesus only knew that this woman touching him was a sinner, he can't be a prophet because he doesn't know she's a sinner. Of course, this man, like so many of us, didn't know what he didn't know. If Jesus had known that she was a sinner, he would have cast her off. If Jesus had known that she was a sinner, says this man, he would have sent her away. He would have segregated her. The only reason she's in my house is because my house is open to the rabbi. She has come, but she's a sinner woman. Of course, in my mind, it's your house, and you know she's a sinner. Why don't you put her out? I had some other comments I'll save for another time about that. And so then there's this sense of, Jesus says, let me tell you a story, which he does. And it's interesting because even once the story is told, this man doesn't get it. Well, notice how Jesus begins. He calls the man by name. Simon, come over here. I need to talk to you. This was one of those not going to shame you moments. Let me talk to you in private. And then he goes and he tells him the story. And here's what Simon doesn't get. Simon, this woman is not the sinner we are worrying about tonight. You're the one. You are the one who invited me to your house, and you did not extend to me the ordinary customs of hospitality. You're the one. She came with an expression of intimacy. But you think that she's the one who sells intimacy when in fact you are the one who is trying to purchase and sell intimacy. Now, if my mama were here, I could tell you what she would call this man. It starts with he and it ends with the word that you are thinking about. It's this sense of you are capitalizing on my importance. You are making yourself look big by having me dine with your friends. You are giving the appearance of closeness even though you are not close. And what do you call an exchange of presumed intimacy for a price that is hollow and without love? Faith-based intimacy requires that we have the love that is the fruit and generated by our faith. And it's not enough. Sometimes I'm driven crazy when I hear people that want to apologize for stuff. Apologies don't mean anything without intimacy. Don't sit in your meeting, in your convention hall, in isolation and tell me how sorry you are about something that is happening with me, but you don't come to me and give me a hug, a kiss, maybe a reparation. Don't tell me about how you have seen the light, but you do not want me still in your pulpit, in your sanctuary, because of my gender, because of my sexual perceptions. So, sin should not lead to exclusion. Sin should not lead to segregation. Sin should not lead to the denial of the fellowship of believers, but it becomes an opportunity to declare how much we love because of our faith. And so, faith-based intimacy is the result of transformation, not transaction. The woman, when she entered Simon's house, had already been in a process of transformation. She did not come into Simon's house looking for a blessing. She was not trying to buy a blessing with her tears or with oil or with the kisses planted on Jesus' feet. Those were not a matter of transaction. They were the signs of the transformation. Simon says, doesn't Jesus know that this is a sinful woman? And the woman in her heart, maybe, Simon, you knew me as a sinful woman out there, but something has happened to me once I got in here. The text doesn't even tell us how it is she came to Jesus. It doesn't say that she heard his message. It doesn't tell us that he touched her in one way or another way. It doesn't say anything about how the transformation took place. What it says is he's lying down enjoying supper, and in the midst of that, she's there crying on his feet, washing them in a way that his self-righteous host did not offer him water to do, that she is there drying with her hair, that she is there anointing his feet with oil and showing intimacy that is a result of her transformation and not the transformation of not the transaction of the street, but the transformation of the heart and of the spirit. Faith-based intimacy is that which allows us to be emotionally vulnerable and spontaneous. I'll say that one more time. Faith-based intimacy allows us to be emotionally vulnerable and spontaneous. Now, I know that some of your faith traditions, people like to get up very often and say, come on, let's give God some praise. That's nice. Directions help people sometimes, especially when they don't know what to do. I have problems, though, when people say, let's give God some praise, because you may be trying to tell somebody to do something that they're not really feeling. God doesn't want our fake praise. God wants our real praise. If the worship leader can't look out in the congregation and see that there are people just about to burst because they need to shout or run or clap or do something, then they need to just be quiet. They need to wait until they see the Spirit moving in such a way so that when they say let's, the people are already into the act of praise because they're feeling a Spirit that makes it spontaneous. And see, that kind of spontaneous praise puts you in a position of vulnerability. It makes you throw your head back and not worry if your wig falls off. It makes you run around the church, and if your pants fall down because your belt gives way and you forgot to put on your suspenders that day, you don't worry about it. You just step on out of them and keep on running and shouting. It makes you vulnerable. It puts you in a position where you don't care what the folks say about you. You don't care about what the folks think about your praise. What you know is you've got a burning of love in your heart, and it wasn't for their show. It was for your expression of a faith that made a difference and was transforming your life. Faith. Based intimacy is Christ-centered. This pericope ends in an interesting fashion because after Jesus has the conversation with Simon and he tells the woman, your sins are forgiven, you find out that Simon's friends are just like him, except they couldn't keep their mouth shut. Who is this who forgives sins? And Jesus was a great ecumenist in that he knew that there's a time to pick your battles, and that was not the time. He could have told them that this is a child of God. He could have told them that this person has been through a transformation that you have not been through. He could have told them how he had seen this woman and also seen them and also known Simon and Simon's thoughts in ways that they couldn't even begin to imagine, because he was one in the same with that power that not only created the earth but also blew into humanity the breath of life, so that these living creatures made in the image of God, these living creatures, these children, these special, these beloved, these for whom God cares. He could have told them that, but he chose not to. He said instead, woman, your faith has saved you. Go now in peace. Let your life be wonderful because your faith has saved you. Look at what happened. Jesus talks to Simon and reads Simon's mind. Jesus knows the woman's mind and her heart and knows what she's been through and knows how she's been transformed, knows how she believes and knows how she's committed and knows how she's got this visible sign of faith and unity, and the visible sign was clear with her tears, with the vulnerability of taking her hair down and wiping his feet and anointing his feet with oil and kissing him. She was intimate, but it was faith-based. And when you find that you are Christ-centered, you find all kinds of special and marvelous things begin to happen in you and around you. When you're Christ-centered, you do not get segregated. You get integrated. When you are Christ-centered, you become pulled from the externals to the internal. When you are Christ-centered, you know that your sins have been observed and they have been forgiven because your heart has been fixed and your shame is taken away. When you are Christ-centered, you are able to stand with holy boldness and you are able to proclaim justice in the land. When you are Christ-centered, you feel the streams of mercy flowing in your heart. When you are Christ-centered, you fall in love with Jesus.
you would, it's not in the program, but where I come from, we stand when we say the Nicene Creed. Can we stand? Can we stand? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, suffered death, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. As we offer our prayers of intercession, I would invite you to position yourself to be in conversation and listen for God. I will lead us by saying who we are praying for, and in your own way, in silence, lift up prayers by names or with specificity. Then we will conclude our prayer with the litany as printed. O Lord, tonight we offer prayers of intercession for the Universal Church, for its members and its mission. Let us pray. O Lord, we offer prayer and ask for intercession for this nation and all in authority. Let us pray. O Lord, we offer prayer and ask for intercession for the welfare of this community. Let us pray. O most holy God, we offer prayers of intercession for those who suffer and those who are in any kind of trouble. Let us pray. Creator God, we lift these prayers and offer intercession for those who have departed from our presence, for their families who grieve, for the vacancies they've left, but the memories and legacies we hold in our hearts. Let us pray. Holy God, the earth you created in beauty now languishes in pain, waiting for its redemption. The peoples of the earth, whom you created to live together in peace and joy, now experience violence and despair. Transform us and our churches uniting in Christ, that we may become your ministers to this world and its people. Together, make us bold in our struggle against cruelty. Give us courage and endurance to accept no peace where there is oppression, and to work for justice, God's shalom, and the common good. Help us speak to the conscience of our country and its institutions. Use us to heal the brokenness in life. Renew our joy so that all creation can sing the glad songs with which the world began. All this we pray through Jesus Christ, through whom you make all things new. Amen.
Thank you.
one of the 8 marks of commitment within Churches Uniting in Christ is the celebration of the Eucharist or the Lord's Supper together. Every time we gather, we intentionally celebrate at one table. Tonight, this is how we will proceed. We will do the litany and the prayers of consecration. Then, following the Lord's Prayer, Bishop Leith, myself, and Elder King, senior moment, will bring communion to you. We are using the cups that contain both the bread and the wine. So once you receive it, please prepare it, but don't partake yet. Once everyone has been served, then we will commune together. Should I come down? Loving God, in gratitude we remember on the night before the crucifixion, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, you broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and after giving thanks, gave it to them and saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." In gratitude for what Christ has done for us, we proclaim our hope. Holy God, send your Holy Spirit upon us in these gifts, that all who eat and drink at this table may be one body and one people, a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ. Through this meal, invite us with the risen Christ, so that we may give ourselves for the life of the world. Through us, bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and freedom to the oppressed. Give us the power to work for justice, that all the world might be filled with joy and peace. This sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving we offer you, eternal God, through Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. With the confidence of the children of God, let us pray. Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. Deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Bread that we break is communion of the body of Christ. Take, let us eat together in thanksgiving. We who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. The cup of blessing for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. We who are one body, a one body, for we all share in the one cup. Let us stand. One bread, one body, one Lord of all.